Good morning and welcome to the 22nd meeting of the Finance and Public Administration Committee in 2022. As you may note, I'm Daniel Johnson, the Vice Convener of the Committee, sitting the chair, as the convener has unfortunately lost his voice this morning. And I would ask my fellow committee members not to smirk or smile at that fact. Indeed, I have asked the clerks to investigate whether there's been any foul play, not that I'm looking at John Mason in particular. Anyway, we are very pleased to have with us this morning the Scottish Fiscal Commission. Indeed, our first item on the agenda is an evidence session looking at the four new reports that they published last week. Members will have received copies of the forecast evaluation report, the approach to fiscal sustainability consultation paper, trends in Scotland's population and effects on the economy and income tax, and the SFC's fourth statement of data needs. Without further ado, I welcome to the meeting Professor Graham Roy, who is appearing before us not for the first time in person, but certainly the first time as chair of the Scottish Fiscal Commission. We also have Professor David Ulfe, who is a commissioner, and Claire Murdoch, who is head of social security and public funding. And I believe that John Ireland is unable to make it. He is also unwell. I intend to allow up to 90 minutes for this session before we open. I will invite Professor Graham Roy to make a short opening statement before opening up to questions from the committee. Professor Roy.
Thank you very much, and thank you very much, Vice Convener, for the opportunity to come along and speak with you all this morning. Last week, as you said, we published four reports, two in our regular cycle and the others the start of our work on fiscal sustainability. I wanted to just give you a couple of highlights from our forecast evaluation report and the statement of data needs. Now, as you know, income tax data are released 16 months after the end of the financial year. That means we can now evaluate our forecast for 2020-2021. And Scottish income tax revenues were £417 million lower than forecast when the budget was set in February 2020. Now, you'll recall that was before COVID was declared a global pandemic. And crucially, therefore, although Scottish revenues were lower than forecast, revenues in the rest of the UK were lower too. The net effect will be a positive reconciliation of £50 million. Now, this is the first positive income tax reconciliation so far. And you'll note that this is more positive than a negative £221 million reconciliation we forecast in May. And this is mainly due to equivalent UK tax revenues being lower than the OBR's March forecast. For the devolved taxes, revenues from land and building transactions tax were £221 million higher in 2021-2022 than we forecast, largely because house prices grew faster than expected, as did, crucially, the share of residential properties in the top tax bands. Devolved social security payments in 2021-2022 were £136 million, or 4% higher than when the budget was set. Now, importantly, this evaluation does not cover the new disability payments, adult disability payment launched nationwide only last week, and we do not have the data yet needed to evaluate our child disability payment forecast. Our statement of data needs highlights the need for significant improvements in data produced by Social Security Scotland. This is essential for forecasting of spending and any evaluation of the effectiveness of social security programmes. I should stress that current data limitations may result in larger forecast errors in the future with implications for Scottish Government's social security budget. There is good news, though. We've agreed a memorandum of understanding with HM Treasury, ensuring we have access to information if the UK Government make changes which affect devolved taxes and social security. On fiscal sustainability, we published a consultation paper last week setting out how we plan to approach this task. We propose a measure of fiscal sustainability that will look at the projected gap or surplus between spending and funding. To start, we published projections of the Scottish population and illustrated its effects on economic growth. And given trends in births, deaths and migration, Scotland's population is on track to fall in the decades to come. Now, in the scenario we set out last week, we estimate that there will be nearly 900,000 fewer people living in Scotland in 50 years' time. With the Office for Budget Responsibility projecting the UK's population to fall by only 2% over the next 50 years, Scotland's relative position of a 16% fall is clearly more challenging. Crucially, the number of 16 to 64-year-olds will fall, so there are likely to be fewer people working. Indeed, for every 10 people between 16 and 64, there are currently three older people, but by 2072 this increased to 6 older people. So a smaller population and fewer people working will affect the economy, leading to slower economic growth, and this will have implications for future Scottish budgets, which we'll explore more fully when we publish in March. Now, what the aim of the Fiscal Stability Report is designed to do is to help politicians of all colours by looking at key structural challenges that we think will shape the health of the public finances in the long run. And we hope that they help pinpoint the ways in which the long-term finances may not be viable and motivate change. And ultimately, we hope that our work can assist the planning needed to protect the sustainability of the public services that we all rely on. And with that, Vice-Convener, I'll hand back to you for questions.
Thank you very much, Professor Roy. And before opening up to questions from my fellow committee members, I'd just like to ask two or three opening questions. I mean, in broad terms, these reports essentially, to my mind, both look at how effectively your forecasting has been to date, but then also look forward to how that could be done for the longer term. So with that in mind, I mean, given that we know that Social Security, in terms of your previous reports, would suggest that it is a very, potentially leading to quite a significant gap in funding, around 700 million, as I recall. Could you just elaborate a little bit further about the data requirements and the issues that you pointed out, both in the report and in your opening remarks?
So I think there's a couple of things. So, and it's important to distinguish between our forecasts that we do for the budget, which is the medium term, the next 5 years, and then these longer term projections, which are much more about looking at, from a high level, the aggregate trends that are going to face, in our economy. And for that, we do it's much more higher level data that we draw on. So looking at demographics, looking at levels of economic growth and so on. Where I think the data needs are really important around the Social Security is about that immediate forecast for the next 5 years in terms of the medium term. And what we need for that is really good data to look at how trends in the economy or how trends in take-up or how trends in eligibility, etc., will feed through to our immediate forecasts. And at the current moment, we don't have the data that we need to be able to do that accurately. There's some aggregate data on the overall levels of number of people claiming benefits and overall value. What we don't have is robust data on, say, average payment of individuals or, say, by gender or and things like that, which have been available in the past through DWP when they do it for their benefits. We don't have that data yet for Scotland. So that means that our ability to forecast becomes much more challenging for the next 5 years or so, and then that makes it more difficult to provide accurate forecasts.
I mean, very obviously, you need that sort of disaggregated data in terms of, average payment type, and who is claiming what and when. I think that's a sort of a crude summary of what you're after. And you say that you've had that in the past. Could you maybe just explain what's preventing you getting that data for Social Security Scotland? Is it systems? Is it organisational issues? Or is it some other reason?
So I think we engage Social Security Scotland regularly to make our data requests. I think the key thing for me is getting access to that data as soon as possible. Ultimately, the provision of that data is an issue for Social Security Scotland and the Scottish Government. So I couldn't really comment too much on that. The point I want to stress is just the importance of getting that data, and crucially getting that data now, because it's not just about having the decomposition of the data to let us project forward, but we need to have the time trends that go backwards as well, because that's ultimately crucial to having accurate forecasts. So we can't have any breaks in the data, because that makes the forecasting more difficult. The other point I'd make as well, though, is an important challenge for us in terms of our ability to forecast the accuracy of the data. It's also a really important challenge to evaluate policies as well, because you need to look at what's the impact of new policies to encourage take-up, or what's the impact of a new approach to Social Security. You can't really know whether these are having an impact unless you know what the data is telling you. So it's an important issue for us, but it's also a broader issue that's important for scrutiny as well.
I mean, understandably. Can I just clarify a little further? I mean, do you believe that data is being captured and therefore it's just a question of accessing it? Or is it an issue with the new agency not capturing the same level and detail of data that you'd previously have expected from UK social security agencies.
I don't know if whether Claire wants to come in on that. I think the key for me is ultimately asking for that data and getting that data. But Claire, do you want to maybe say anything about engagement you've had?
I can do. So in our statement of data needs, we've almost split the recommendations into two groups. One is about data dissemination, as in Social Security Scotland will hold that data in some form, but haven't been able to make it available to us or other users. And the other one is about data collection. For most of the data, it's about they are either holding it or how the clients are transferring from DWP to Social Security Scotland. It's not quite clear whether we'll still be able to get the same data. So if you think it's most important for the disability payments, and most of these clients are on the DWP system at the moment and will move over to Social Security Scotland. And at the moment from DWP, we can access fantastically rich data in terms of number of clients, age of those clients, gender, health condition, award level, payment amount, and we can use that to do our analysis. It's not clear when they move to Social Security Scotland quite how that data will be captured. And then we have all the new clients applying to Social Security Scotland, and that data they should hold but haven't been able to extract or make available to us. So there is a dissemination issue. There's also a data collection issue around sex and gender. So at the moment, it's not consistently collected. DWP have it on the application form, and we use that information because the gender of people is correlated with how many applicants we have or which conditions they have. It's particularly important for child disability payment, and it's not clear that Social Security Scotland are collecting that in a consistent way. So we've got these two sort of sets of recommendations around dissemination and collection, and then we have a number of other recommendations to ensure that Social Security Scotland is sufficiently resourced to make sure we can get the data that we and other users need. And we also recommend that they set up a user group, because we're not the only users of Social Security Scotland data, and they should be speaking to other users, but not in a sort of group forum. And finally, we would like Social Security Scotland to develop a tool so that we can access the data in the same way that we currently can from DWP, which has proved very useful to us.
Thank you very much. Chris?
An important feature for children is that we know that some types of disability are more prevalent amongst boys than amongst girls. So that's why it's really important to have the breakdown by gender. And at the moment, Social Security Scotland are proposing to collect that gender information through the Equality Impact Assessment rather than through the application form itself. And that poses two problems. One is it can be quite difficult to link the impact assessment to the actual application. But secondly, there is an option on the impact assessment to say you prefer not to give the information. And so we may miss that rather important information. And it's because we do our forecasts from a very detailed, broken down level, that if we cannot match the data we get on outturns to that easily, then first of all, we find it hard to understand what errors we're making in our forecasts. We can't correct our forecasting methodology, but also we can't rebase our statistics on the more detailed breakdown and use that as a basis for future forecasts. So it really does raise the prospect of potentially significant errors in our future forecasts. And if you think that we're forecasting disability payments of around $3.25 billion, even small errors there may have huge consequences.
Indeed, I won't ask any further questions on this, but clearly having access to data that is rich, disaggregated, and also has continuity from legacy social security payments is of critical importance, and I'm sure that's something that the committee will want to take up in the future, and may well be a number of other questions from other committee members on that particular point. Just want to ask two final questions. First of all, just in terms of framing this session, clearly the last 18 to 24 months has been highly unusual, if I can put it like that, and have stress tested your methodology to the greatest extent possible. And indeed, I note from your report, commentary about the accuracy of employment data compared to OBR with your use of RTAI rather than LFS. I was just wondering, in broad terms, what lessons have been learned by the unpredictable nature of the last period, and how that's going to inform your approach, both in terms of normal times, quote unquote, if such a thing exists, and indeed in the context of future shocks.
A couple of immediate reflections I would say on that. So, the last 18 months have been very unusual, but we are living in a longer period of uncertainty. We've spoken before about even the changes of the last decades in terms of what's been happening to the Scottish economy, and it's likely that that period is going to continue. So forecasting is going to remain really challenging for the foreseeable future. A few things I would say about that. I think if you look at the forecast evaluation, it sets out very clearly where the errors, if you can call them that, have arisen, and where the changes may suggest the numbers moving around. The first thing I would say is that if you actually think about the way the fiscal framework works, the common shocks across the UK, you see that working through in terms of the reconciliations and the fact that our forecasts that we're talking about for income tax were made before COVID hit, and you see that our forecast being out by over £400 million, but the same forecasts were out from the OBR as well because they were also under forecasting. So that, under this framework, means that the framework works because both the block grant adjustment and the taxes are operating. So I guess that's the first reflection I make on the broader comment about the operation of the fiscal framework. I think in terms of in the specifics of the forecasting, David might want to come in on this as well, but just in terms of understanding about the data that we're using to forecast employment, for example, and the difference between using the RTI data and the LFS, and the potential for that to have slightly different variations between what you're using on that. The RTI data, we think, is a much better source for Scotland because it's a much richer data set and has much more information. But then how that then translates to what the OBR might be using with the LFS potentially is something we'd want to look at going forward. There have been changes to the methodology about how the economy is forecast and how that feeds through to the various tax forecasts over the last few years. So using a much more bottom-up and a much more informed model by the years of experience the Fiscal Commission are now getting in terms of being able to forecast the economy and taxation. So actually refining the models, and the models become more sophisticated but more attuned to what's maybe happening with the Scottish data, but also what's potentially happening in the differences in the forecasts from the past. So there's been some model improvements as well as, I think, a better understanding of the data on that. On Social Security, we've touched a bit on the challenges, particularly around the data. And one point I would make about that, just coming back to the conversation we've just had there, Social Security payments that we've been forecasting so far have been arguably easier to forecast because they're based upon entitlement to other benefits. So there's a much, much greater understanding of who's eligible. The challenge is when you're moving to the disability payments is that they're less connected to other benefits. So the potential spread of error in that becomes bigger. So that's why the accuracy of the data is really important there. So I think maybe David and Claire want to come in. I think there's significant improvements in the data over the last 5 years or so that then can be used to inform the modelling. I think the models are becoming more sophisticated and we're able to understand what's driving these errors. I think where the big thing is the play around the data and the Social Security, and that's going to be an important thing over the next few years.
Thank you.
Maybe one thing I could add would be that one thing we have learned over the last few years of analysing our forecasts of income tax is there's a big difference between what's driving average earnings in the rest of the UK and average earnings in Scotland. And we think that's largely down to what's happening in the financial sector in the south of England. There seem to be levels of bonuses etc. there that are not materialising in Scotland. So a question that we have to face is, in our future forecast, do we build into our forecast the fact that we're now systematically under systematically underperforming relative to the rest of the UK in terms of average earnings, and build that much more into our understanding of how we do the forecasts in the future, and in some sense correct for that, because it's the difference between what's happening in the rest of the UK and what's happening in Scotland in terms of earnings, and hence income tax, that drive some of the reconciliations. So because we've learned about this, we can now start to think about how do we systematically correct for that in future forecasts.
So Professor Wolf, you touched on a really important facet, I think, that's been of real interest to the committee when we've looked at the reports over the last year. So just as a brief follow-up, and I'm mindful of the time, colleagues, to what extent will the long-term fiscal sustainability report seek to not just you include that in the forecast, but also seek to sort of understand and explain some of those long-term trends? Because I think, it's one thing to observe them and forecast them correctly, but for, as policymakers, we want to understand why that's happening so that we can make policy decisions to address them. So what extent will it seek to explain those sorts of differences you just outlined?
Pick up on some of those factors. So for example, one thing we've been observing in Scotland is that participation has been falling relative to the rest of the UK. And that is partly driven by these long-term demographic factors. To the extent you have more and more elderly people in the population, that's going to have a big impact on participation in the economy. So our long-term projections will pick up on some of the drivers that are driving some of these differences between Scotland and the rest of the UK. But we may not be able to pick up on all the factors that are driving that in the long term. But that was precisely one of the motivations for doing fiscal sustainability reports. Is when we do our five-year forecasts, there are lots of moving parts in those forecasts. Lots of things are changing around. So it's quite hard to see what these long-term drivers are that are behind some of this. So the aim of our fiscal sustainability report is to say, well, if we can take one or two of those long-term drivers, and demographics are certainly an important part of those long-term drivers, and push those forward, maybe holding other things constant, then we can start to see the long-term impact of that on the sustainability of tax and spending programmes.
Thank you very much, Professor Ulf. At this point, I'd like to hand over to my colleagues to ask questions, and I'll hand over to Liz, then followed by John.
Thank you. Professor Roy, I was interested in what you were saying about this issue with regard to social security data. Are there any other aspects of the data collection that are causing you any problems? You said that data has improved in a lot of areas. Is there any other aspect of the data that you need besides the social security problem, or is it just that social security?
I think the first thing to note is that we've made a number of statement of data needs over the years, and there has been welcome improvement in the quality of the data information provided by the Scottish Government, by HMRC, and that has been very welcome, and it has helped improve the accuracy of the forecasts. And we can always do with better data, particularly around the employment data, the improvements to RTI and access to data of over years, that we can start to look at the impacts of policy changes. So I think we're in the statement of data needs, we set out some other areas of data requests on the economy and on tax, some improvements we'd like to see in terms of the way the government use productivity data, because that's ultimately crucial for our GDP forecasts. But the social security data is the most pressing one at this particular point in time, and for two reasons. One is in terms of just the lack of clarity and the lack of information in order to be able to do projections. But secondly, the scale of these social security payments, they are very large, and as David said, small errors on a very large number can lead to quite significant numbers moving around.
That's
helpful. Just in relation to what Ms. Murdoch was saying about that there are some issues about the consistency of the data within that social security problem, can that be fixed quite quickly? I mean, were you surprised about the extent of this problem that the DWP has obviously had historically better data and Social Security Scotland, albeit a new body, doesn't have that? Can this be solved so that there is consistent data? Because as you rightly say, Professor Roy, it's absolutely essential that we get this fixed, given the scale of what we're talking about.
I mean, I think most things are solvable if they're prioritised. So I guess that's the thing that Social Security Scotland would need sufficient staff and to have this as a priority. At the moment, they are delivering payments to clients, and that's arguably the most important thing. But then how you collect the data on that, how you disseminate it, has important consequences for our role and for the government's budget. So I think it's not insolvable at all. But what's important is that they backdate it to when the payments started being administered.
So are there really two issues? And you have some concerns about the resources that are required to go into solving this problem. But is there a specific issue as well about if it's a consistency of the data, do we need to do more to align the data that the DWP has had and what Social Security Scotland has? I mean, is there a sort of methodological alignment that needs to take place as well as solving the resource problem?
I mean, ultimately, this comes from administrative data, so it should be similar and it should be consistent in terms of to administer the payments. They need the same information in terms of who they're paying, how much they're paying them, why they're paying it, what their reward amounts are. So they should be holding all that information, which is ultimately what we can currently get from DWP. So I think apart from the issue around sex and gender, which we've spoken about, the rest of it is more about the dissemination of that information rather than the collection, is our understanding.
Okay. Professor Roy, can I just ask one more question, convener, if that's all right?
Professor Alfred. I think our perception is it's not a lack of resources in the sense of there's not enough money in Social Security Scotland. They are just struggling to recruit the suitably qualified staff to help them to actually marshal this data and put it into the form that we need. So it's a lack of resources, but more on the supply side rather than on the funding side. I think Social Security Scotland have the funds to solve the problem.
So that's a particular worry then? Okay, thank you for that. One more question. Professor Roy, just in relation to the recent problems in the census and the collection of data, which obviously, as well as all the other aspects of collecting relevant data for economic forecasting, to what extent have the problems in the census, given the lower rate of response, affected the work that you're doing for forecasting?
So the census is ultimately crucial for a large part of the data we use on population. I think obviously once we see the census data, and crucially from our perspective, we have any information on levels of confidence interval around the data, then that's going to be really important. So I probably can't say too much on that until we actually see and we hear from NRS in terms of potential confidence intervals, particularly around people who might be in receipt of benefits and things like that, then that will be important. So it's something that the census is obviously crucial to what we do. So having that and then having a dialogue with NRS will be really important for us.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Liz. John, and then we will go to Ross.
Thanks very much, convener. I'll not make any... Well, you're convening the meeting, so but anyway, there's a debate over that. I'll not make any jokes, if I can. I think to start off again with the data needs, because that interested me quite a lot. In your report, I think it's pages kind of towards the end, pages 28, 29, there's an annex, and this is about previous requests, and some of them say in progress, and some of them say no progress. And I'm intrigued by these titles, which could mean quite a lot of things. In progress, I mean, if it says in progress, are you broadly happy that things are moving ahead, albeit slowly? For example, I mean, I take the point that a statutory right to access of information from UK government departments may end up being part of the fiscal framework. So in that case, there's a timetable for that. Some of the no progress ones, I mean, VAT, so maybe that's not urgent, but, you know, are you broadly happy with this, or?
So I think we can, I think there's a couple of things to note in there. I think in progress can mean that we might be actually engaging with them on the data. No progress might be that we don't actually have any information, but that's not to say that the work is not being undertaken. I think broadly speaking, I think that we are making progress, good progress on a lot of the data aspects. I come back to the point about it's the Social Security that's the really key bit. Some of the things as well might be is that, again, what this doesn't do, and again, it's something we can potentially reflect on or do, is about the scale of these things. So these are what we've asked for. This is how it's progressing. Some things will be really important. Some things will be less important. Some things will refine our estimates. But in general, I think you can see there is quite a lot of progress across the board.
Okay, fair enough.
Yes. I think this memorandum of understanding we've signed has been really important, because when we talk about data, there's different types of data. There's numbers, but there's also information about possible policy changes in the future. And what this memorandum of understanding will do is make sure that if there is thinking going on inside the UK government that could have implications for Scottish taxes or spending, we will get access to that early thinking, which we weren't doing up until now. So that, I think, is a very definite step forward.
Right, that's helpful. Now, as I understand it, you're not planning to produce another report like this for 2 years. And given that you seem to think that some of this is quite urgent, can we at least have an update before 2 years, or why 2 years?
Yeah, so I think the reason we didn't update it for 2 years is largely because I didn't think there was probably not too much to update. I think, particularly in the Social Security stuff, I think that's something that we would be keen to keep updating on. And I think that's, given the importance of that for the committee's work as well, then I think we can take that as an action to provide an update. Whether we do a full statement of data needs, we can then look at. But I think, yeah, I'm more than happy to commit that we'll update on progress.
That's great. I think the committee will be interested in pursuing that within 2 years. Moving on into Social Security, again, I was interested in some of the comments in your report. In paragraph 2.7, it said, however, the new systems used by Social Security Scotland are currently not designed in a way that meets our priorities and other users' data needs. So, I mean, there's also been the suggestion that there's a lack of resources, but if they've not been designed in the right way, you know, that suggests that's not a lack of resources, that was a lack of foresight or whatever, or consultation earlier on. So which is it? Is it resources or is it?
I mean, I think a couple of things. So the first point, I think, coming back to Claire's point around the way the data is collected, but then also the way it's disseminated. So I think within that, the dissemination of the data, the systems that are there to disseminate the data, is absolutely crucial. I think the example is that if you go to DWP at the moment, there is a really accessible statistical tool that lets us have the information that we need to do bottom-up estimates of eligibility to criteria. That doesn't exist, so that's a key part of the system that doesn't exist, that lets us go in and to do these and do these calculations. So I think that's the key bit for me in the system that doesn't yet exist and is really important that is produced and is therefore accessible to people.
There's also the steps behind that within Social Security Scotland. So that in DWP, you have the administrative system, and then the data is taken from that and put in a statistical form, which the statisticians can then use to put into this tool, which we then use externally. And it's those steps which, our understanding is, the Social Security Scotland statisticians are not getting all the data. It's not that they're getting the data and then not sharing it. They're not able to get the data from the systems, but it doesn't mean that it's not held in some form.
Would you say these are just teething problems? Because it's still, relatively speaking, a new body. DWP has been going a long time. So is it just teething problems, or is there something more fundamental?
So I'd, I, can't really comment on the specifics of the operations on that. Right. I think the only point I would come back to, though, is two things, whether it's teething issues or something more substantial, the importance of getting the data, but crucially, the importance of the getting the data that then lets you have the consistency over time is absolutely crucial, A, to look at the forecast, but then also B, in terms of how you evaluate the policies.
Because, I mean, some of the specifics, and I mean, terminal illness gets mentioned as a specific, that they didn't have the numbers of people who were getting a payment because of terminal illness. And I would have thought, you know, that was quite essential. So again, on that one, is that because they just don't have the information or they just haven't worked it through the system yet?
Yeah. Do you know the specifics of that one?
I mean, they should ultimately have that information, because if you have a terminal illness, you qualify under special rules for these payments. So they will be making the payments on that basis. So they should have. But I think, again, it's how that information will be held somewhere in the system, but not extractable in the form that we need. Because at the moment, from DWP, we can tell whether somebody was a new client onto PIP, whether they're under special rules for terminal illness, or whether they were reassessed from disability living allowance before. So there's different categories of people, and the trends that we see in those different groups are very different because they're naturally different types of clients. So it's all these different subgroups, which is what makes the disability payments a lot more complicated for Social Security Scotland to administer as well. So the scale of this is very different to what they were doing for the other payments. But it also means it's a lot more difficult for us to forecast, evaluate our forecasts, and then ultimately try and provide the best forecast that we can for the Scottish budget.
Okay. I mean, the question of sex and gender has been mentioned already, and that's obviously quite a hot political issue. Now, am I understanding it correctly that for older people it doesn't really matter, some adults it doesn't matter quite so much, although I'd have thought that with men dying generally sooner than women, that would be a factor, because if women are going to claim benefits for longer, there would be a greater cost to that. But there seems to be more, from what Professor Ulf said, amongst children, that there's more specific conditions that boys have that girls don't have, and vice versa. So is it mainly children we should be, that you're focusing on for the needs for this data?
The only answer to that is that we don't know, because there may be conditions that emerge in the future that do turn out to depend on gender in the elderly population. And if we don't have the data, we can't even do the analysis to understand whether that is the case. So it'd be better if we had the data, even though it doesn't look like an issue at the moment. It could become an issue. So it'd be better if we had the data to understand whether it's an issue, and then to use that for future forecasting.
Maybe you can't answer this, but have you any idea if this is a political decision because we're not wanting to emphasise sex so much nowadays, or if they just hadn't thought about differentiating collecting the data?
It's ultimately because of the application form. They want to capture the information they need to process the claim. So they don't need to know somebody's gender in order to process a claim. So that's why they are not collecting it on the core application form.
Okay, thanks. I mean, you also talk, I think it's page 14, about you'd like to have more early engagement, I think, with as they presumably look at their processes. I'm just looking for the right chap. Oh, yes, 249. We would like early engagement with the Scottish Government on data requirements for these payments. So is that something that's progressing as well? Is that something that's improving?
Claire, do you want to? You're the one closest to the engagement.
I suppose we have had regular conversations with the Scottish Government about our data needs over the last, 4 years. But what we can see now is, with the data they're collecting on the disability payments, where there are real issues here for us. So we want to continue those conversations, particularly where they're in the process of designing the new systems, so to make sure that the systems for the payments which haven't yet launched can be designed in a way that makes it easier for Social Security Scotland to get us the data that we need.
Okay, thank you. And I think finally in this bit, I noticed in 2.55, the accounting treatment of PIP was mentioned. Well, as an accountant, that kind of jumped out at me. I was puzzled as to what the importance of the accounting treatment was, or how there was an issue there.
I'm just trying to find
It's 2.55, third last line. And if you want to come back to me on that, I'm happy enough.
I mean, I think the broader issue which is, we're picking up there is the difference between the financial data that we're ultimately collecting at the end and the statistical information that we have to make the forecasts. And there is historically always been a gap between that accounting information, the financial data and the statistical data that we use. I think what was interesting this time was that gap was bigger than it has been in the past. And I think that that's something which we need to understand and reflect on for the next round of forecasts, whether that gap is going to close. So that's the broader issue which is being picked up there.
If I could just elaborate there. The issue arises where somebody makes a claim and there may be some issues around that claim. So the claim is actually delayed in being made before it's finally signed off. And that means that the person making the claim will be entitled to some back payments. So when the claim does come through, there are these additional back payments coming through. Now, when we just get the numbers of people who are claiming and get entitled to certain awards, we just forecast the number of people and the amount of award they get. We're not picking up all these back payments necessarily. So that's where the discrepancy between the fiscal and the statistical data is coming in. And that problem seems to be somewhat greater for disability benefits, for obvious reasons that of people with disability issues, it may take longer to fully assess their claim and validate their claim. So there's more likely to be back payments involved in that. So that error might be somewhat higher there.
Okay, that's helpful. I think I understand that. And I just, if I can, just touch on one area in the population report. And that was around earnings, because you make the point, this is chapter 419, we've seen Scottish average earnings grow more slowly than the UK over the last 5 years, but your assumption is going forward that they'll grow broadly in line with the UK, and I just wondered why that change, and is that over-optimistic going forward?
So I think this is one of the things that we're trying to do in the fiscal sustainability report is to separate out the different factors in there. So what we're doing is really here is looking at population projections, and that's essentially the core bit that we're pushing forward and just saying, if you take our stock of population at the moment, make some reasonable assumptions about migration, what might be the impact on the economy, and then ultimately what might be the impact on the public finances. So we're looking at one thing in isolation. You then write, there's then other things that we need to look at, things like potential earnings. We spoke a bit about that in terms of participation rates, about the strengths of some sectors in Scotland relative to the rest of the UK, so whether that be in energy, whether it be in financial services, and how might that impact upon long-term projections. What we do here in the population paper is just essentially make the easiest assumption, which is we assume productivity the same as the UK, earnings the same as the UK, everything else the same, but we're just changing one element of that, which is the population. And that will be our approach more broadly for a lot of this fiscal sustainability work, is not to try and throw everything in the mix and come up with a number that generates headlines, good or bad, but actually just to say, so here's an issue, which is our ageing population and our demographic change. This is how it could impact upon the economy and then therefore the public finances. Here is another issue, whether that be economic performance, whether that be climate change, whether that be whatever the consultation, what people would like us to look at, and then trace through the impact of that on the long-term public finances as well, to help people understand what the key issues are rather than ultimately what one particular number is.
Okay, thanks, Camille. Thanks, Dan.
Thank you very much. Now move to Ross, to be followed by Michelle.
Thanks. I just, in the first instance, just like to briefly pick up on the explanation that Claire gave around why certain points of data aren't collected in the social security application process, because it's not necessary to process the claim. Caveating this question with saying, I accept you're not Social Security Scotland, so if you don't know the answer to this, that's fine. But I presume the reason that they're not collecting as part of the application process what would otherwise be very useful bits of demographic data is because the more fields that you add to the form, the more people drop out of the application process. Is that the case?
Good question, Claire. I mean,
It may well be the more you do with the form, that might be a particular issue. And I guess there'll be particular reasons about what you're trying to do with the form, what you need to process the application. I guess the implication then, though, is that by not doing that, that then has consequences for your ability to evaluate and ability to forecast. So it's not really a question I think we can answer. It's probably a question that Social Security Scotland can answer. But the outcome is that, it makes it more challenging in these areas to forecast.
Yeah, thanks. Perhaps something worth the committee getting in touch with Social Security Scotland about. My main line of questions around your consultation process. I'm quite interested in how you've been going about that with the fiscal sustainability review. Because you mentioned a couple of the examples of the kind of priority areas, key factors that you mentioned are climate and health inequalities. Those are both issues that have pretty robust third sector organisations in those spaces. Are those the kind of organisations who have engaged with Fiscal Commission consultation processes in the past? Do you have an established relationship with these kind of groups, or is this a new approach to try and get a wider level of engagement?
It's a really good question, and I think a couple of comments I would make. One of the reasons that we focus on demographics is because it's probably the area where that the most is known from economic perspective about how it might impact on the economy and the public finances. And it's also the area where we probably have the greatest understanding as commissioners and as a team within the commission, and also the strong links with the stakeholders. If you take something like climate change, our understanding about how climate change will impact on the public finances over the long run is still in development. OBR published their first report last year, and that was really the first attempt they've had at trying to look at these things. So for us, there's quite an important learning curve about understanding how issues such as climate will impact through onto the economy and the public finances. And then a key part of that is the stakeholders to work with on that. This will be new for us in that space. So thinking about who are the key stakeholders, whether that be in third sector organisations, whether that be in experts in climate, whether that be in academics, or whether that be in other organisations, the Committee on Climate Change, Scottish Government officials who work in climate change, to understand their work and the impact of the climate, how then that might feed through to the economy and public finances. So that's a big area for us, and part of that is about the stakeholder network that we engage with.
What's that engagement process with stakeholders going to look like? I think this leads to a kind of wider area of discussion the committee have had in the past around public understanding of our public finance landscape, mm-hmm. and stakeholder understanding of it, and the extent to which it is important for certain stakeholders to have a greater level of understanding of devolved public finances than is currently the case. I'm probably going to get a row from all my friends in the climate movement for saying that of all the relatively well-funded third sector organisations in that space, I don't think there's many people who have a real depth of understanding of our public finances, because that's not historically where those organisations and those campaign groups have focused. But their input into this process is probably quite important. So whether it's them or the alliance of healthcare organisations, where it's maybe a little bit different, but probably in roughly the same place, is part of this process going to be you assisting and enabling them to give useful feedback?
Do you want to go first, David, then I'll come in on that?
If I can maybe just elaborate on this a little bit. If we can think of things like demographics, there are well-established organisations which are producing all the data on future demographic trends. If you think of something like climate change, what we would need is organisations that can tell us with the same kind of level of confidence we have around demographic data, what the likely evolution is of climate change and in terms of its impact on Scotland. So you're looking at issues like what's the impact going to be on flooding? What's the impact going to be on fires? What's the impact going to be on coastal erosion? So these are things which will matter for forecasting the resources available to the Scottish economy. But there's other big issues there about if we want to adapt to climate change, how far is that going to be done by individuals spending money on it? How far will it be done through the state supporting individuals to do that? And there we need some understanding of what likely programmes are going to be for policy in the future in those areas. So there's quite a lot we need to understand. So our intention is to try to build relationships with organisations that can help us understand those dimensions. We'll try to translate some of that into the implications for funding in Scotland, but even that core level of competence around what's the likely evolution of climate change, particularly within Scotland, is something we will need to build that relationship with other groups outside the SFC.
I'm interested in what that will look like. So I presume, you know, a punter can go onto the SFC website, fill in a consultation form and answer the questions there. But if you're trying to get that greater level of depth, and particularly from these key groups that you're engaging with for the first time, is this workshops, seminars, one-on-one meetings? What does this look like?
I think it's a mixture of both. And I think that as we start the climate change, once we start the climate change work, a key aspect of that will be is how do we develop a stakeholder plan, exactly for the reasons that you mentioned. One is about how do we communicate that this is important for informed discussion around climate change, understanding the implications for the public finances, good and bad, but then also for us is just needing information and needing that engagement. How can they input into us? And we have great links on the public finances and the economy side. That's what we do. So next week I'm talking to Solace about the public finances, and we've got a regular period of engagement there. We don't have that in the same sense in the climate change, and that's going to have to be a key task for us to go out, see who the key networks are, work with the government and other organisations in getting these networks, but then thinking about what's the best way to engage through workshops, through seminars, through speaking at events, et cetera, that's all going to be really important to us.
Thanks. Just one final question on a different note. Quite a lot of your written submission and what you mentioned at the start, Graham, was about improvements in data and process that should improve the accuracy of forecasts. On the flip side of that, though, given that inflation might top 20% and we're entering an indeterminate period of profound economic instability, should we be expecting greater accuracy in forecasting in the immediate future, or is this going to pay off in 5-10 years' time once we're on the other side of this instability?
I think I'd separate two things out. So one is the better information and the more accurate data that we can get, then the better the forecasts will be, all else remaining equal. And this will be something that will make the short-term forecast better and also in the long-term. You then get to what the situation we're at the moment and the uncertainty and the... I think as I mentioned, the last 18 months have been quite eventful in the economy, and it's clear that the next few years are going to be eventful as well. And that just means that noise in the system is going to be that much larger. So the accuracy of the forecasts and the process for forecasting is going to be that much more difficult. You only have to look at the variations in forecasts of inflation over the last 6 months to see the huge change that's happened in a relatively short period of time. So the more data and the better information we can get, the more accurate the forecasts will be. But that's not to say that that's the only thing that matters. The broader economic climate is crucial.
Thanks. That's all from me, convener.
Thank you, Ross. Michelle, to be followed by Douglas.
Morning. Thank you for attending today. If you can bear with me, I wanted to return back to the statement of data needs and specifically the child disability payment. Now, you correctly note in your submission that while sex and gender sometimes is used interchangeably, they actually have different data needs. And you also notice, and it's been referenced today, that long-term trends in child disability, there's a higher prevalence for certain conditions for males. Given also that you explain that small errors can, over time, have quite big impacts, is there not a case, if you had your preference for sex and gender to be collected specifically for child disability payment and, where appropriate, in other cases?
I think we don't want to come in on the specifics, Claire. I think the general point is the greater the breakdown that we have, then the more accurate the forecasts, will be. The quality of that information is going to be absolutely crucial for the forecasts that we have. So the more information, the better on that. I don't know if you want to come in on the specifics of the split.
So I think in general, I'd say more data definitely is always better. In this case, we don't believe that it would make a significant difference to our forecasting capacity. And what is important is that it's collected in the most appropriate way. We're not responsible for that data collection, so we will leave it to Social Security Scotland to decide whether they should ask the question in relation to sex or gender. We note the Chief Statistician's recent guidance on this. But from our purposes, what's important is that the data in that form is collected, and that would be a real increase in the information that we can use in relation to population projections as well. But it's up to Social Security Scotland which questions they ask and how they ask.
Well, I suppose what I'm exploring is your, because I'm referencing your data needs, not Social Security Scotland. And given that you yourselves point out that there's a prevalence for certain conditions in males, surely the only way you can get to data accuracy is to collect or request sex and gender, and particularly taking into point Professor Ulf's point that there may well be conditions of which we are not yet aware that only occur in males when we look at their sex and mutual characteristics as compared to their gender, where we can all foresee a time where gender is much more fluid. So I'm asking this from your data needs, your specific data needs, rather than any other, you know, and as Mr. Mason said, it's a hot political topic. So if you had your choice of data needs, and given what you say about separating them out, would you prefer to have sex and gender where it is specifically relevant to higher prevalence for certain conditions?
I think just to emphasise what Claire said, I think it doesn't really matter in the context of the forecast as long as we have the information in some form. That's the most important piece in terms of the overall accuracy of the forecast. So quite relaxed about what Social Security would give us as long as they give us a breakdown, which then lets us do the forecasts.
Okay. I wanted to ask about the equality form. I'm very interested in data and accuracy as well. It seems to me that it's almost building in room for error and is obviously inefficient where you have a two-step process in the child disability that you're then having to join data fields. Is that your view as well? And is that why you're stating that ideally from your data collection needs, you'd be looking to have it all in one form?
I think the main thing with the quality monitoring form is just the response rate, and then how accurate then that is. And I think that's where if it's more administrative, so it's more just collected as in the process, the system, then it's going to be more accurate. We know that on where you're, if it's a voluntary form, etc., then the response rate will be much lower, and then therefore much greater error is potentially there. So building it into the actual administrative data then just means it's going to be much more accurate. So that's the key thing about the key concern about it, about the form, is the fact that you would likely get a low response rate.
Does having other people filling in the form pose any further risks to data?
The challenge that we've got at the moment is the way the child disability application form is set up is that it asks for the characteristics of the person completing the application form, which is most likely to be a parent or guardian rather than the child. And that's quite a fundamental thing where, for our purposes, the characteristics of the parent are not likely to have a bearing on the application, whereas the characteristics of the child will do. So that's a very fundamental thing. Beyond that, it's really, I would say these are important issues, but the dissemination issues that we have and the availability of the much more administrative data on number of awards, how much people are receiving, those things are actually much more important than this data collection issue that we have. If the decision is made by Social Security Scotland not to collect that information, we can still produce our forecasts. It may just have implications for the accuracy of those forecasts. But the scale of the impact of this issue is not as significant as the issue that we have around understanding the overall client base, why people are receiving an award, how much they're receiving, average payment amounts. Those are really, really fundamental issues. This is an issue which, whilst important, is not as fundamental to our forecasting ability.
Okay, thank you. I just wanted to also talk to you briefly about the work that you're doing in terms of your fiscal sustainability consultation paper. And I mean, I can see you're already making strenuous efforts to get contribution to it. I saw your piece on LinkedIn, Professor Roy, and so on. I suppose the question is that given, and as you yourself set it out, it's really a very odd setup. You know, you comment that Scotland, of course, doesn't actually have any debt, and you're trying to model something which is quite odd to external people from the outside looking in within the UK. I suppose I've got two questions. You mention yourself that the risks, there's a number of risks that the data that's contained there then will be taken by either side of a polarised debate and used to attempt to prove various things that actually are not true at all. And we've already seen that. We see this for GERS, for example, that's largely discredited by serious economists such as Professor David Simpson. But I suppose you yourself, what risks do you see? And do you think actually all you're doing by attempting to do this, laudable though it is, you're simply embedding those risks? Because how, in other words, a million-dollar question, how on earth can you project fiscal sustainability on the basis that we have of fiscal transfers in Scotland?
So what we're doing, just to be really clear, is looking at the fiscal sustainability of the Scottish budget under the current constitutional settlement. And that's really important because I think then that means that it's of relevance and importance to everybody in the Parliament about what are the factors that will drive that relative performance. So it's very much about the current constitutional settlement, what are the key factors there? Now, that's not to say that the factors that we're talking about will then play into broader debates about constitutional reform, etc. And I'm very relaxed about that because the issues that we're highlighting here are crucially important to the long-term projections and the sustainability and options for Scotland in the future. We know that Scotland's population structure has been shaped over the last 100 years, and that will shape Scotland's economy over the long run, irrespective of the constitutional settlement. There's then a debate to be had that people will have about what you might do about that. And again, our analysis is there, hopefully, by providing really accurate information and discussions around population projections to help improve the quality of that debate. The point about the public, the sustainability within the current constitutional settlement is really important because what it does is it lets us turn around and say, what are the things that might be driving the relative difference in Scotland compared to the UK as a whole? You've then got the factors which are what's driving the sustainability of the UK as a whole and how might that feed through to Scotland. So if we've got an ageing population across the UK, that will have implications for the Barnett Block grant, it will have implications for overall tax revenues. If climate change will have an impact on the UK and in Scotland. So these are things that will be shared across the UK. What's then really important under the current settlement is how Scotland might do relative on these issues compared to the UK as a whole. And then finally, and I think probably the most important bit for me, is irrespective of the overall funding envelope, what the work will be doing is showing about where the spending pressures are within whatever that spending envelope looks like. So an ageing population means that even for a fixed amount of budget, you're going to have increasing pressures on the health budget because of that ageing population. So I think what we're trying to do deliberately is to set out what the particular issues are rather than immediately come to some particular number about whether the economy is sustainable or not. And that's quite a deliberate effort. And I mentioned that in my answer to John Mason about thinking about what are the key issues, so focusing on population, and then thinking about how that might impact on the sustainability of the Scottish public finances. And that's the approach that we'll take on this, and that's the approach we'll take on everything else.
Can I maybe just add something here? You're certainly right that because of Scotland's fiscal settlement, we don't have a measure like debt to GDP ratio that other fiscal institutions can use. But in some ways, we're using the most fundamental measure, the gap between funding and spending, because that's what ultimately drives the debt to GDP ratio anyway. So we would argue that in some ways by picking up that funding gap, we are isolating the important measure of long-term fiscal sustainability, and that the debt-to-GDP ratio is essentially a corollary of that rather than the more fundamental measure.
Yeah, I understand that. My last wee question, short question, thanks, Vice Convener, is given the nature of, or the principle of fiscal transfers, have you looked at equivalent reports in other countries that may not have an entirely similar fiscal transfer basis? Obviously, I'm aware of other countries, but in general terms, how they attempt to kind of model this scenario?
Yeah, so we cover that in the report, again, just looking at what other countries do around fiscal sustainability reports. The point you make is correct in that when you look at other countries, so independent nation states who are issuing debt, that's typically the approach that people will use to look at the debt. So what we're doing in Scotland is relatively unique in that context, in the sense that we're looking at the system within a model where you have pooling of large amounts of tax revenues across the UK and then a block grant still making up a significant amount of money to the Scottish budget. And that is relatively unique in that context for doing a fiscal sustainability report. I come back to the point, I still think it's really important to do this, because what it does is it starts to frame the conversation about whatever, irrespective of whatever constitutional settlement that you think of in the future, or irrespective of what might be happening in other factors in the economy, etc., you've got these big structural drivers coming, changing your economy over the long term. And the sooner we can have a debate and a discussion about what we do about these issues, then the more sustainable you will make your public finances in the long run. And crucially, the better you'll then be able to deliver public services.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Finally, Douglas.
Thanks, Convener. I was just going to go back to the 16% fall in population and compare that to the rest of the UK of just a 2% fall that you mentioned, Professor Roy. And you mentioned how you've done analysis, how it could impact the economy. But I guess that's done based on the powers that we have at present. And as a committee, we are looking at additional tax raising powers, additional devolved finances, I think that Ross mentioned. So has there been any analysis done that could inform us as a committee, when we're looking at additional powers, what this change in demographics would mean to us and our economy going forward? We've mentioned in the past things like air passenger duty, fuel duty, VAT, pensions potentially at one time could be devolved. And I would imagine there'd be a huge impact to the Scottish economy when we look at our change in demographics, where we've got a much less working population and a greater number of elderly. So is there any data that we could see around that when we're making those decisions?
So I think the general point I would make is that, so first of all, what we're trying to do is to analytically show the scale of the challenge and the relative performance between Scotland and the UK. And what we're not doing is saying this will happen. What we're saying is that if you take our population just now, look at recent trends in migration, but also Scotland's track record over a long period of time about out migration and have a discussion about how you attract people to Scotland, make some broad assumptions about how you think the economy will perform, then you can show the relative scale of the challenge that's coming down the line. By doing that, what we then hope to do is to do exactly what you're then alluding to, is to say that if we face this relative challenge, what do we do to potentially address this? Some of that will be discussion about prioritisation of public services over the long run. Some of that will also then be about how do we change the nature of the structure of our economy. So how do we cope with a smaller population? How do we cope with a slightly older population? But then also, how do we potentially attract more people to come to Scotland? How do we grow our economy more quickly? How do we improve productivity? Because all of those things will start to improve the economic outlook. And I think that's what the purpose of the Fiscal Sustainability Report is really designed to do, is to set out here, if you take one issue such as population, this is what will happen, these are the impacts that will have through into the economy. But that's not to say it will happen, because then the ball then gets placed back in
policymakers' court to say, actually, well, how do we do this? How do we attract more migrants to Scotland? How do we think about the rest of UK migrants coming to Scotland? How do we boost our productivity? How do we grow our tax base? These are all the things which I think ultimately are able to be much more informed by having a projection set out like this.
I guess also another question was, you know, there's a huge difference between, you know, population going forward in Scotland and the rest of the UK. Historically, has there always been a big difference, or is this something new that we're seeing coming through in the last few years?
So there's a long history about Scotland's population and the demographics of that. And you obviously have a period pretty much through the 20th century when, for a large period of time, the natural growth in Scotland's population was offset by out-migration, and we were a nation of exporting people for a large period of time. And if you actually look at for the most of the second half of the 20th century, Scotland's population didn't increase, and that's in stark contrast to most European countries who were seeing positive growth in their population. So Scotland's got a long history of challenges in that in population like that. More recently, it's been more positive. So if you look over the last 20 years or so, particularly the accession of the EU countries, Eastern European countries, international migration increased, as did our UK migration as well. And these effects combined with, a smaller birth rate helped to boost Scotland's population. So I think one of the big things I think that is important for us to have a conversation about as a country is about the future demographic projections that we have and what we might do around that. About if we've got an ageing population, there's relatively limited what you can do around things like birth rate, but there'll be things there you can do to encourage natural growth in the population as much as possible. There's then questions about thinking about if you've got an ageing workforce, about how you might try and encourage people to participate in the labour market for longer as a result, as they're getting older. But then also, how do you make Scotland attractive as a place to come in and live and work here? So the demographics bit has been around for a long time, and that's going to be something that's going to be crucial going forward.
You mentioned, you know, when people retire. Is there a big difference between Scotland and the rest of the UK around that?
Differences in participation rate. So as you get older, then participation rate tends to fall, and we see slightly bigger fall off in participation rates in Scotland as people get older relative to the rest of the UK. Whether that will hold going forward is one of the big unknowns. But from a policy perspective, it's what do you do to try and encourage more older workers to remain in the labour force for longer?
And I guess that's what government need to come forward with, those policies to try and encourage that to happen, to increase the participation rate going forward.
Yeah, very much so. And again, what I would argue about what's the value of these reports is that when there's lots of real short-term pressures on policymaking and thinking about, you know, what we do in for the next year, 18 months, about how we support our economy, that's quite rightly where the vast majority of the focus is. But thinking about how over the long term we boost things like participation, about how we change our skills system to encourage older workers to remain in the labour force, how we have more flexible working practices that let people work longer as they move through the age profile. These are all the things that might not have an impact in the next year, 18 months, but it's the sort of thing that will have an impact over the decades to come.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, convener.
Thank you, and thank you, Douglas, for not asking the follow-up question about what things you can do to boost the birth rate. We've got a few minutes left. I just want to ask two follow-up questions. So first of all, in terms of fiscal sustainability, the key variable or the variable that you're looking at is population change. One of the things, looking at your consultation paper, is that the change in the population, you know, from an upright pyramid to an inverted one is not smooth. You know, so for example, looking at that data, there's sort of a glut of 30-year-olds. So to what extent does that complicate the forward projections? So you're trying to sort of do as sort of consistent and isolated a forecast as possible. But how feasible is that, given that it's not a linear change that we're seeing in the population?
So the answer is that demographics are very complex because it depends both on the total population and the distribution of the population as to how that's going to move forward. And demographers will tell you that some of these effects play out over 50, 100 years when you're trying to look at the long-term effects of this. So that precise distribution really does matter quite a lot in terms of trying to think forward as to what's going to happen to the population. And we're trying to take that one level further by trying to translate that into what's going to happen to participation in the labour force. So you're going to translate that effect on population into a participation effect in the labour market. And then there's all the other effects on the economy, like productivity, unemployment, etc., you have to factor in as well. So we're trying to strip out some of these factors and focus very much on the demographics that are driving this.
I think the important thing to realise is that we use the language quite carefully. That these are projections rather than a forecast, and they're very much about taking aggregate high-level numbers and pushing them forward. So you're right, there will be bumps in how the economy will evolve over time, but what we're trying to say is, well, look, you know, if we've been averaging international migration into Scotland of 20,000 over the last X number of years, if that was to fall off post-Brexit, whatever, different changes in migration policy, then, OK, it might be higher than that in one given year, it might be much lower than that, it might be negative. But if it's smaller than that, then this is the effect it might have on Scotland's economy. Or if our population age profile continues to increase, if we don't change participation rates as we get older, then this is the effect it will have on the economy. Individuals within those years might work a bit longer, they might work a bit less, depending on what happens on savings and in pensions. But the overall trend over 50 years is a key thing that we're trying to highlight and to showcase.
And just finally, in your forecast that you produced in December, I was really struck by the regional breakdowns that you produced. I mean, I recognise they were extrapolated from ONS data, but particularly around growth in employment, earnings and total tax take, because I think it showed Scotland's relative position, not just to our UK, and indeed I think that the relative position with the other devolved nations is important, but actually to other regions of England, such as the North East, North West and South West. That's not something that you've replicated, though I am told that I could replicate it if I went to ONS. I've tried. It was a bit beyond my data analytical skills. But to what extent, both in terms of your presentation, will that sort of regional breakdown form part of it, but also in terms of your ongoing analysis, both in terms of your forecast and in the longer term work? Because it strikes me that comparison, not just with our UK, but other perhaps comparable parts of England, is a useful comparison as we grapple with these issues of demography, productivity, and growth in the economy.
I would say two things. So obviously our main forecast is on the aggregate Scottish figure in public finances. That's what we do in terms of our medium-term forecasts. But I think the understanding about what might be driving these numbers on a regional or sector basis is really important. So David mentioned the point about London and financial services. And if you have a very good year in the financial services and large bonuses, and they score in the City of London, that is going to have an impact on the Scottish budget in relative terms, because that growth in UK earnings is in the block grant adjustment, but it's not going to show up into the Scottish figures. So that's important. The other one, obviously, is adding to your thing, is regional variations within Scotland. And again, what we covered, I think, in the December report was the variations across Scotland, in particular what's been happening in the northeast of the country over the last few years in terms of earnings and in terms of employment, given the changes in oil and gas. So I think understanding both variations within the UK and how that might have an impact, but crucially the variations within Scotland. And I think that's something that then feeds through to the long-term projections as well. And it's why things like, we know that oil and gas and the energy sector has been a really valuable source of Scotland's economy over the last 50 years and has contributed to Scotland doing relatively well across the UK as a whole. We know that we're going to have to transition away from that over the next 50 years. So how do we do that? Not just from an environmental point of view, but then from the projections that we're having in the economy and the public finances, that will have implications as well to create high value jobs, high earnings, which in turn will feed through to the tax revenue. So thinking about how
what might be happening in this, in the regional structure and the sectoral structure of our economy will be crucial on that in terms of those projections on those projections too. So unpicking all of these different elements and how they will feed through to long-term projections, I think, will be something that's really important. What we've done so far is just do a very aggregate population, but then, as you're alluding to, you start to unpick some of these variations in terms of economic performance, then that will too have an impact on the long-term performance.
I think just to add to that, I think we've tended to use these regional stories to understand what's going on in the data rather than as the basis of our modelling. As Graham says, our modelling is done at the aggregate level, but sometimes we want to understand better, well, why is it coming out that way? So that's the reason we've started digging down much more into the regional data and presenting that in our reports to provide some context and understanding of why we're seeing some of these trends in the aggregate data.
Indeed, something that I found quite illuminating in your December report. Well, with that, that draws to a close our questions. I'd just like to thank Professor Graham Roy, Claire Murdoch and Professor David Ulf for their, as ever, enlightening contributions. And that concludes the public part of today's meeting. The next item on our agenda, which will be discussed in private, is consideration of our work programme, and we now move into private session. Thank you very much.